asking each other about advice that situations modern people still find challenging. What do we do when we get mail 5 times a day? What do we do when the telephone interrupts again? People have been asking themselves these things for years, writing about them. We focused our lens of inquiry upon the late 19th century and began gathering objects to aid our inquiries and be our teachers. And we're going to tell you just about a few of our adventures from that time.
So, we're going to do a little bit of the talk. We're sort of going to bounce off each other. We haven't prepared anything, specific beyond her reading there. But I want to encourage everyone to ask questions at the end. We're probably going to save some time at the end for people to ask questions. One thing, when people think of the Victorian era, like Sarah said, people often have a very romantic or fanciful idea of the Victorian era. The Victorian era itself covers a very long period of time. And those images of romance and the very sort of non-specific ideas of, oh, this old time past, are often, people imagine the past as if it existed in sepia tones at the time. And they imagine it in the way they see artifacts in a museum, behind glass, still, stationary, preserved.
And the problem with that is they rob it of its life. These people weren't doing these things to look sepia-toned. They were doing this because this was their world. This was everything around them. And it was living, a living part of life.
And the people who lived then were real people. One of the interesting things is that when people imagine people in the past, they often come up with a pretty narrow range of stereotypes. They come up with a certain set of categories of the way that they think all people were. And one of the things that we learned studying more and more in the daily writings and just the magazines of the past, the diaries, is that people were just as varied and different as they are now.
And if you think of your best friend, some of you are here today with your best friends, even though they're your best friend, you still have differences between the two of you. And you have a lot of similarities. But there are things that are different, too. And the same is true if you take any two people from the past. Even the ones they have a lot in common with, they're still not the exact same person. And all too often, people say, everyone in the past was like XYZ. But it's important to remember that in any culture, past or present, whether you're talking about America or a different country, every person in that culture is an individual. And no one meets everything in stereotype.
Right. So one of the biggest things that we've realized the more we look at the past is that the people in the 1880s and 90s weren't particularly different from us. They weren't different in a wide range of ways. Their interests, their physical characteristics, if you look at the average height, this bike fits me, I'm 5'10". And this is the most common size they sold back then. And that's because the most common height for men back then was about 5'10", not what it is now. And you hear a lot about nutrition being so different, people being smaller. You look at the beds, which are smaller, and it's like, oh, people were smaller in the past. And beds are smaller because people tended to sleep sitting up or propped up on pillows. And so you learn a bunch of things, and the more we learn, the closer we get to these people weren't that different from us.
And even down to who they tended to fall in love with. We don't always fall in love with the exact same people other people expect us to. The people who lived in our house in the 1890s were the children of, their father was the son of Irish immigrants. Their mother was a native Klallam woman from the local tribe of American Indians. And the Klallam tribe prefers the term Indian to Native American. That's why I use that term, in case you're wondering. And a lot of people, when they hear us say that, they say, oh, well, that must have been very unusual to have a biracial family. And we say, actually, these were the grown children of a family. The father moved out here in the 1850s, at which point there was nowhere near enough white women to go around. And rough settlers are not known for celibacy. There were a lot of families like this.
It was very common in our town. We live in Port Townsend, Washington. I don't know if we But the more we think about this, and the more we do our research in the past, and we realize that what the biggest differences are between that society and ours are a lot of these details and technologies. These are the things that really separate things separate that period of history from us today. And what we've been trying to do with our lives is to take a lot of that history, a lot of those details, a lot of those things that we see that are different, and make as much of it real as we can. We're trying to bring that into our lives. And again, it's not about cutting things out. Yes, we do cut out some modern technologies, but we certainly still engage with the world, and we use the modern technologies, we use the global economy the way it is now. There's no way to avoid that. One of the things that people often do is they look at us and they think that we're thinking that we're absolutely authentically living exactly as it was in the past. That is completely wrong. We, better than anyone else, we know that that is impossible. And what we're trying to do is bring enough of these technologies, ideas, customs back into modern life and show people their reality. We try to show people what these things look like being used, how these things worked in practice. And in addition there, what we're trying to do is show people that these things are still perfectly possible for us to do or use or be today.
That just because something is old does not mean it is not a good option. That it might not be marketable these days, and there might not be multi-million dollar companies making money off of it. That doesn't make it bad. That doesn't mean it can't still be useful.
It also means that it doesn't still provide a really good pattern for a happy life. Not everyone is happy with modern technology. Not everyone is happy with modern clothing. Not everyone is happy with modern society. There are lots of options available to us. The past is a whole template of options, of technologies, of ideas, of ways to live, ways to interact with the world. And all of these options are still valid. All of these options are still something that we should look at and not rule out just because, oh, that's old. So I'll tell you a little bit about how we got started with a lot of this. So we have different backgrounds, but academic backgrounds in studying cultures, studying the past. And when I was...
I've got a degree in cultural studies, and one of them, he has a degree in history and a master's in library science.
And I was a reformed ex-computer science major who did not graduate from that because I dropped out because I realized how much I hated that technology. And so that also informed a lot of what we do. For us, our entree into this particular, into what we've started doing, what's become our lives, is that we ended up starting this with the clothes. I think that a lot of you guys can probably understand that. The clothes are a lot of things that, basically there's a lot about the clothes of the Victorian era that attract people. They're beautiful. There's no way to get around that. And we started to collect antique clothes to study them because we were interested in the daily life of the 1880s and 90s. And there's a lot of things about daily life that don't get written down. There's a lot of things that are just too normal every day. Why would we bother to write that down? And we can learn a great deal about that by studying the clothes. We can learn about the posture. We can learn about range of motion, everyday activities. We can learn about how the clothes fit and, you know, how different clothes fit for different activities. And in order to do that, we started to put these clothes on. We started to wear them for doing presentations, for doing talks. And the thing we learned quickest was, well, you can't just put those on for an afternoon and know everything there is to know about the posture and understand everything there is about the culture. And you basically can't learn everything that those clothes could teach you.
Right. It's like saying, okay, well, I have a 30-minute ballet lesson. Now I'm ready for the Bolshoi. Not really.
And so we started to copy the clothes. Sarah started to copy them herself. She started first because she has sewing skills. I do not. Sarah started hand sewing everything. She's been hand sewing since she was a kid. And she started to copy the antiques and just work up her own patterns based on those antiques that we have.
I've been sewing since basically before I could read. When all the other kids were out running around playing soccer, I was just inside sticking bits of fabric together.
And while I had to work on a great deal of exercises in the gym in order to get my posture somewhat improved from my horrible posture, in order to be able to fit Victorian men's jackets especially in a good way, Sarah needed a corset. And first experiences with the corset led to her first book, which came out a couple of years ago. And her first book covers the whole story of her first year wearing a corset and all the changes and all the learning that happened during that year.
Because up until that point, I had always seen the clothes as something very beautiful. I'd seen the pictures of the women in the books. These are very beautiful women. But I could never look that way. And I've also heard all of the stereotypes, all of the misconceptions people say. Oh, well, those break ribs. Oh, well, those are uncomfortable. Oh, well, women couldn't breathe. And I had believed those things, because no one ever told me any different. Just like if I was living in a country where people said, oh, well, you know, people in that country over there, they all do this. They all do that. They're all like this. It never occurred to me to question them. And actually, when he gave me my first corset for my birthday 6 years ago, I kind of thought he might give it to me because he'd been kind of hinting at it, and I told him not to. But he did anyways. And so just to humor him, it was my birthday, after all. I don't want to spoil my own birthday. I tried it on. And I realized I could breathe. I wasn't uncomfortable. It was good for my back. And I started asking myself, oh, and I, by the way, this might come as a really big shock. I didn't drop down dead. And so with all of those stereotypes instantly just crashed to the ground, I started asking myself, okay, what else have I always believed that everyone knows? What else might be wrong? What other things are there to learn? And so that's when I started making the clothes and wearing them every day. And that eventually led us to asking, okay, well, there have been all these things about clothes